Okay, do you see this recording? Yeah. Okay, so let's start. We are already more than 100 people participating, so let's not waste time and let me open that Gavi talk. It's really with huge pleasure that I'm welcoming everyone in this talk. We started this discussion on real-time monitoring like 1 or 2 years back, as we call on the pre-pandemic time. And thanks, you know, to the very strong technical leadership from UNICEF and WHO, there was a big push for Gavi to really prioritize this work on real-time monitoring or real-time planning and monitoring of immunization campaign. And the work started. We had learned a lot from all the countries' experiences, and then the pandemic started. And actually, very quickly, we realized that this work was even more important. So we are coming back today with all those learning from the application of real-time monitoring approaches to COVID-19 work. And I'm very, very happy to have Rwanda here present. You're always leading this great digital work in immunization area and also other areas. So I'm very glad that you're taking a bit of time to really share your lesson learned with everyone. This is great, and thank you for your commitment. And I'm also again very happy and pleased to have UNICEF and WHO in this priority area. So I will hand over to UNICEF, and we will come back at the end for question and answers. In any case, do not hesitate to use the chat and also the question and answer. We can answer all the questions all along because I think the topic is very rich. So over to you, Raquel, I think, or Voshi, I don't
know. It's actually to me, Karine, thank you. So good evening, good afternoon, and good morning, everyone. My name is Wojciech Koprowicz, and I have a dual role at this stage in UNICEF. I'm substantively the regional chief of ICT in UNICEF South Asia, but at the same time, I'm also the chief ad interim of the UNICEF ICT Division Digital Center of Excellence. And I would like to warmly welcome all of you to this webinar. I would like to particularly welcome the presenters and panel members from the Ministry of Health in Rwanda, from Gavi, from WHO, HISP, and also my UNICEF colleagues. I also warmly welcome my UNICEF colleague, Fui Meng Liu, who will be taking over from me as the substantive chief of the Digital Center of Excellence. Just as a bit of an introduction, the Digital Center of Excellence is the headquarters unit of UNICEF's ICT division. It is field-facing, and it works with the program teams and national partners, enabling the digital transformation of programs. Some examples of which you are actually going to hear about today during this webinar. DCOE work includes digital innovation, technology for development, digital public goods, and other field-oriented technology initiatives for UNICEF and our partners. We will have a very rich presentation and discussion today. And as you can see, we have a number of presenters from government, from WHO, from HISP, and also from our UNICEF colleagues in Rwanda. And they will be sharing with us, sort of the lessons learned and experience in terms of utilizing the technology in large-scale immunization campaigns. So I invite each of the presenters, when they start their presentation, to perhaps introduce themselves. Can we move to the next slide, please? So far as this webinar is concerned, we already started with the initial welcome remarks, but basically you can see that the structure of the webinar will be starting with the introduction to planning and implementing real-time monitoring approach to strengthening immunization campaigns, and that's introducing the guidance for country partners, as well as the lessons learned and the technical approach for Rwanda. So we will have the presentation by UNICEF Rwanda itself, two presentations from the colleagues from the Ministry of Health in Rwanda, also from HISP Rwanda, and then reflections of our partners from WHO in Rwanda, and that will be followed by the question and answer session. As Karine has already mentioned, if you have any questions at any time, please feel free to raise those, through the chat, and then we will be doing our best to answer these questions as during the Q&A session at the very end. So once again, I welcome you warmly to this webinar. I hope that you will find it very positive and very helpful to your work. And without much further ado, I'm going to pass over to my colleague Raquel. Over to you, Raquel.
Thank you very much, Wojciech. Good evening, good afternoon, good morning, everyone. My name is Raquel Wexler, and I work in UNICEF's Information Communication Technology Division's headquarters, Digital Center of Excellence, and I support system strengthening, planning, and coordination. And it's a pleasure to have you with us here today. This work, I just want to say, has also been very much co-led by my colleague in UNICEF Immunization Health Team, Imran Mirza. So I just wanted to give a very quick background, to this work around strengthening campaigns using real-time monitoring approaches. So the Gavi Alliance and UNICEF have been working over the last year on the consolidation of lessons learned and good practices on the use of real-time monitoring approaches and tools to support vaccination campaigns across countries and across regions. And last year, Gavi and UNICEF released a publication, which you can see before you on the slide, called The Use of Digital Technologies and Approaches for Real-Time Monitoring Supplementary Immunization Campaigns, Good Practices and Lessons Learned. And so in addition to looking at the four country cases that you can see before you, Pakistan, Indonesia, Uganda, and Zambia, an extensive literature review was also conducted by Johns Hopkins University, which finalized that report. The point of this is, of course, not only to enable faster collection of data, but more importantly, the use of data, real-time data, for corrective action and to improve program effectiveness. And of course, as Gavi and UNICEF, WHO, and our partners, we are tech agnostic. So we were looking at a variety of digital tools and solutions that have been employed to support real-time monitoring as well. And ultimately, the emphasis of this work is about strengthening national systems and capacities through the support of digital tools and approaches to ensure that we all align our work with existing national health information systems and architectures that are currently in place. In addition to this, we've consolidated this experience over time, and now we are releasing or having a soft launch today of a companion piece of work, which you can see on the right-hand side of the screen, which is planning and implementing real-time monitoring approaches to strengthen vaccination campaigns, guidance for country partners, because we have seen that our partners around the world have been asking questions about what is real-time monitoring? How do you go about planning and implementing real-time monitoring approaches. And so we hope that this will serve as a very useful reference guide for you all. Next slide. And just very quickly, these are what you can see before you are some of the benefits and uses of real-time monitoring approaches for vaccination campaigns, include improve planning to support the achievement of campaign targets, to improve service delivery, to reduce vaccine hesitancy and increase trust in demand, to improve enhanced data quality, safety improve with more timely AEFI detection and investigation, reduced misuse of funds. The use of real-time monitoring we've also seen has improved better collaboration and partnerships and communications between all levels, as well as, of course, to support overall course correction and corrective action. And with that, Karim, we'll move to the next slide. And so here we go. So we have also, we're just releasing today, a new country technical brief on the use of real-time monitoring approaches for COVID-19 vaccination in looking at the country case of Rwanda. So one of the things that we are trying to do together, WHO, UNICEF, and Gavi, is to rapidly document document country experience in the use of real-time monitoring approaches for COVID-19 response and to make that information available very quickly through country case studies and technical briefs, as well as through webinars such as these. So the one that has been released today documents three use cases for Rwanda. It also includes good practices and lessons. And in addition, you know, to the version which is in English, which just came out very much today, we're also in the process of developing a French version of the technical brief. And as mentioned previously, this presentation will be given in French in a few weeks for our Francophone country partners as well. And with that, I will pass on to my colleagues in UNICEF Rwanda. Thank you. Alphonse, you're muted.
Yeah, thank you, Raquel. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. I'm Alphonse Nyandwi. I'm a technology for development specialist with the UNICEF Rwanda Country Office. I'm with my colleague, Dr. Kondwani, who is the health manager with the Rwanda Country Office. So UNICEF in Rwanda have been supporting a comprehensive digitalization integration of digital health information systems across the health system levels, from community to facilities to central levels, and that to improve quality, continuity, and efficiencies and health service delivery. And some of our interventions, we include but not limited to the intelligent community health information system and its integration with the other digital health information system, whether it is the DHIS, which is more at the central level, the electronic medical records, the civil registration and vital statistics. And also before COVID, UNICEF have been supporting the immunization tracker or immunization register for routine immunization. And that have been helpful to repurpose for the electronic immunization register system for COVID-19. That have been in collaboration with the many actors, especially the Rwanda government, HISP, as a provider of technical expertise in customizing different solutions and other development partners. So I think that is what I can share for now. Maybe with the question and the answer, we can provide more information. Over.
All right, thank you so much. I think it's my turn to present. I'm called Bogatwe Hedson, and I'm the head of public health surveillance within RBC, which is an implementing entity of the Ministry of Health. So I'm going to present on how digital solutions have been shaping the response within the country. And I would like to, this presentation, be zooming in to how it has been helping into surveillance in particular. So, moving to the next slide. Next slide, sorry. Yes, so, Okay, next slide. All right, so thank you so much. So the country has been relying on public health measures in curb the rise of cases. So, they've been relying on hand washing and had other sanitation, and they've been also relying on the use of masks, physical distancing, but also most important to the widespread testing. We also leverage on different approaches. So we use drones, where drones have been spreading good information about how people should be preventing from COVID. But at the same time, at the port of entry, we put in place some robots where people were educated on how to prevent from COVID, and also the the good use of masks. But the most important part is the use of data to guide intervention. And moving to the next slide, you see that the country has been, the pandemic has been evolving into different waves within the country. So so far we have moved from four waves, where the last wave was most driven by Omicron, and third wave driven by Delta. But all these were being led, or the different interventions that were put in place to mitigate or to curb the burden of COVID. And with all these, the digital solutions has really emerged to keep pretty low. It has really played a critical role to make sure that people get information, people get data, and also communicating what we have already, and also gathering all the information from the central level to the central level. And with all this data, it has been guiding our policymakers to put in place different interventions, especially the non-pharmaceutical interventions, including curfews, but also even lockdowns. So moving to the next slide. Yes, looking, zooming into how this data has been flowing, you can see that this is just one of the examples where we have been receiving data from different districts, and all these provide us with the current situation during the last 7 days. So if you look at the how now the incident rate has been evolving, now we have in all districts have been recording fewer and fewer number of cases. And that all this thanks to the good data that we have been getting from the central level, from health centers, and from all point of entry that have been testing at different levels. So moving to the next slide. Yes, so I'll just say that digital solution has really emerged as a critical or important aspect in curbing this pandemic, where we have been getting a lot of data from different levels, both at health centers, and with all those kind of information has been guiding interventions, where the government actually have regular meetings to put in place some of the measures, including curfews and also lockdown. So moving to the next slide, you see that apart from, I wanted to zoom in into how the digital tools we use in surveillance, but let me just flag out on different tools that have been used during this pandemic. So we have been using digital tools or solutions into different areas, including case management, but also in self-monitoring and also self-awareness, where we have a tool called 114, where people can enter and also have all information on the situation and also be able to screen if he or she is positive, then he gets tested. Also, we have also different tools, but the most important one is the use of PLF. The PLF is a tool that is being used for people or passengers entering the country. With the PLF, people would be able to access all information, but also the most important is the PCR test, where he or she can book a PCR test, and which is always taken upon arrival at the airport. So with all these, the main tool that we currently use within the country is the use of the DHS. The DHS have been changing or been playing a key role to make sure that we will get information where people, healthcare providers at the centralized level gather all information related to demographic, but also the most important aspect is on the results of the tests that have been tested. So moving to the next slide. So I would like to give you how during this pandemic we have been shifting from the manual use of data entry and sharing of information and to the current situation where we use the DHS and HMIS to get information, to test, but also sharing other. Previously, we've been using the paper base where samples have been collected, and at the lab at the reception we do register. That's how we used to do it, and then we process the samples. Later on, we enter the sample in the LI system, which was the previous system, and then we proceed to testing, and then the LI system, and then the patient gets the results. But all these were all much more manual. And then all these we shifted. So there's a need to shift from the manual approach to the more digital approach, where samples were collected and put into the system, and then tested. After getting tested, people get results on real time. So with all this kind of information, people are able to isolate on time, but at the same time, the central level gets all the data needed for follow-up, and also to adjust with all other measures, given the fact that all these data have been collected even at the central level. So moving to the next slide, you will see that with the previous approach where we used paper-based, all this was very long process. It required a lot of work, and also sometimes it was also difficult to really process. We also missed some of the information, how to trace even urgent samples, and also the turnaround time was really very long. And this all led to the delays in the work, and also people and clients were not really happy with this approach. So this shift really helped to make sure that people get data on your time, get results on your time, but the most important is that it also guided policymakers on the situation, given the increase of cases, and also make sure that we follow patients on your time. So moving to the next slide, please. So you can see that moving from sample collection to sample processing, up to the result sharing, all these are embedded within the Android app, where samples have been entered and all demographic information entered within the DHS system, and then later on processed within the lab. And also the lab have access to all this information, and then they just enter the results. So we have a team which is dedicated to enter the results. So with all this, we're able to test more than 4 million people during this pandemic, and getting real information, real data that will enable them to move around, and also have access to different infrastructures. But at the same time, so it has been helping to make sure that people travel safe and with the results within the system. So moving to the next slide, you see that next. Yes, this is just one of the examples where someone was tested and then get the results. And with all these, we had an option, given the lesson learned and complaints, we provided different options where people get results using the SMS, but at the same time also be able to access the results using an email or even using this kind of portal within our website. So with all these, it really helped us to make sure that we satisfy the needs of people on field and who have been tested. So moved. Next slide. So again, the most important aspect of the DHS, we were able to in addition to have this information being generated within this system, they were able to get certificates. These certificates have a QR code that can be verified before departing using QR code readers, where even before having access to different infrastructures and even different gatherings, people show their certificates, and then we read their codes and be able to really to understand if this the certificates are genuine or not. So with all these are really some of the solutions that came on board and have really played a key role, not just only to provide data, but at the same time have really helped into satisfying the need of people and also making gradual opening safe for most of people. So next. So I've just showed you one of the codes. It's a QR code and it's being used within this certificate. Whenever you have this kind of certificate, we use any kind of code, even using the Android, we verify and make sure that this certificate is genuine. So we have been observing, coding a few number of cases where people present at the airport without a genuine certificate. And with this QR code, we'll be able to pick if the certificate is genuine or not. And this has really helped us to ensure that people really are satisfied with the service that we provide. So next. Yeah, the most important aspect of this system is that we were able to link it up to different systems. So one of which is the use of locator form, where everyone traveling from outside the country is able to access this kind of locator form, feed the information, feed the demographic information, and be able to be tested upon arrival with all demographic information being collected. So we have also linked this with the ESP driver system. This is very important since Rwanda is a landlocked country where we rely on drivers to bring in goods. And so with the ESC approach, we're able to at least have the link of the ESC driver system within the HMIS, and people could have access in different countries of the results that have been shared within this platform. Next. So I've just given you some of the highlights on how these digital solutions have reshaped this pandemic within the country in different levels, and also how this use of data have been helping us into establishing different non-commercial interventions like curfews and lockdowns. And this has led to curbing the burden of COVID within the country. But with all this, it comes also with some of the challenges that we learned and also some of the lessons. So moving to the next slide, you find that use of data and technology really has really helped us to guide decision-making, where policymakers have been relying on the data that we provide on a daily basis to understand the pattern of the disease and also putting in. We also leveraged on different collaboration, partnership with different partners to have this work done. We also partnered with HISP, Rwanda Go partners, and also other government teams who brought together to make sure that we put in the system in place that provides real-time information for intervention. So we also, all this we have been adapting to different changes, different based on specific challenges. One of the challenges maybe I would like to highlight is that during this period, we have been receiving complaints where people, data collectors, have been facing challenges entering data. And with all these, we use this Android version where data were entered within the system without even having the internet connection. And then they can also synchronize afterwards and have all that data being captured at the central level. So one of the aspects or the most important part is the use of single or uniform client ID. With the DHS, it has enabled us to use one ID system where someone gets tested and then we follow up on that patient and then we link it with the different case management tools for the easier to follow up on those patients. So it's really good to have all those kind of information and also using one single data, one single unique ID to link up on the follow-up and also for any time there's any infection, we'll be able to capture all those kind of key information that will get future intervention. So the most also, the last critical part is the we adapted everything based on the end users. So we are really engaging end users, providing feedback, and we have really adjusted given the situation during this pandemic, and that we really kept on improving this system at this point. Thank you so much.
Yeah, good morning, good afternoon to all of you. I think it is my turn to go through the presentation related to COVID-19 vaccination real-time monitoring. I'm very happy that I'm going to present after Dr. Edson, my colleague from RBC. So my name is Sibomana Hassan. I'm the EPI manager for Rwanda. EPI belongs also to RBC, Rwanda Biomedical Center. And Rwanda Biomedical Center is implementing the aims of the Minister of Health. So with my presentation, I will go through a background of DHS used in Rwanda, and then I will give some update on COVID vaccination in Rwanda, and of course, what we are doing with individual data tracking. All right, so, DHS-2 is in use since 2012. Now it is almost 10 years. And it is being used in the private and the public health facilities. And as you can see, we have 48 hospitals where we are using DHS. We have 515 health centers. And also we are recording the 307 private clinics. And at all levels, we have SOPs how to use DHS-2. And then actually the COVID-19 vaccination real-time monitoring system is not new, because actually we have introduced even before COVID the EPI tracker in 2019, it was in September. And if you look at the number of children we are targeting in EPI, they are now almost 370,000. And in March, we started also to use DHS-2 for tracking individual data, and is helping a lot, as you are going to see, for immunization. Actually, before, I didn't know that DHS-2 can help us the good job we are doing today, because if you look at the number of doses now administered, and also to use DHS-2 and have the report on a daily basis, it is something really impressive. Next slide, please. So as you can see today, our coverage now is at 66%, and for the second dose, 57%, and also have started to give also booster dose. Now we are at 9%. And as you can see, total number of doses so far administered, now we are over 17 million doses. And as you can see here, there is also a report shared on daily basis with the public. Actually, this report, everyone can access the report using this link. So once you go to this link on a daily basis, you can see the report, and there is so many data there. In addition to vaccination data, you can also have number of new cases, number of tests performed per day. So actually we can't do this without this system, because actually with the system, which is web-based and being utilized everywhere with all health facilities, with so many data managers trained and also nurses able to use this system, actually it is helping a lot, because actually for us, it is very easy to have the report on a daily basis. And as you can see what I'm presenting, it is just data for 10. Actually today we are on 15th, so meaning that even yesterday we have updated data. But for this presentation, I have preferred to use data collected on 10th, and you can see actually we can have good report in which we can based on to take also decision on what activities remaining to be performed, and if there is some issues also where to adjust, so that you can make sure that vaccines can be well utilized in all health facilities. Next slide, please. So it is not only the total number of people vaccinated, because actually the system can help us also to know in which district and in each health facility. So as you can see, we have also coverage by district. And as you can see, we are also trying to compare the coverage for the targeted population and also for the general population. And you can see that even the issue of equity, actually it has been addressed because, you know, the coverage now, it is almost the same in all districts. And this is possible because actually it is very easy to monitor what people are reporting and also how many doses administered. And then if we find that there is some district in which even doses are not being utilized, it's very easy to move doses to another district. So meaning that already using DHS2, actually it was a good experience for Rwanda. And we think that also even after COVID, this is a good experience we have to use in other health services. Next slide. So this is the vaccination site, how we are collecting data. Actually, data are being collected before even vaccination. And there is a good flow to ensure that everyone recorded actually can get the shot, because there is a waiting area, there is a recording area, and also there is vaccination. And then after vaccination, there is observation room, and then there is the exit. So it's very easy for us also to monitor that everyone recorded has been vaccinated. We try to arrange our vaccination site to ensure that no one can go back home without being vaccinated, because also this is very important, you know, to track all those data before vaccination. We have to make sure that you can control even people who can not get vaccinated, because actually they can think that with SMS, with being recorded into the system, it's enough. Next slide, please. Yeah, this is our system. Actually, even our system is very, very well protected because no one is allowed to enter the portal. So there is credentials in which we have to ensure that you can log in. And then we have, when you have accessed the information, actually you can try to see and choose the organization unit of your health clinic. And then from there, you can have the page where you can put your data. And it is very easy because actually to record the data from one person, it can't take more than 3 minutes, because now the system is also linked to national ID project. What we need is only national ID number. And when we have that ID number, we have all other information, location, names of that parents, mother, father, which sector, which district, where you live, and also other information can be added, like phone number. So this is also very important because actually it helps to speed up the process. And then once we have also those information related to the profile of the person who is going to be vaccinated, so what we need to add, it is the information related to the vaccines. We don't collect so many variables, but of course we need like some medical conditions. If the person who is going to be vaccinated is allergic to any of the products, and also if he has other health condition, so that you can have also the database, including all information you can need. And then for the vaccine, what we need, it is the type of vaccine, date of vaccination, batch number, and also to make sure that we can give the appointment for the next vaccination. And then once we have vaccinated someone, we have recorded, we have done everything, actually the person will receive in less than 5 minutes also the SMS. And that SMS, it gives the unique identifier. That unique identifier, actually it is the same code she will be using for the next appointment for vaccination, but also that code is used as a credential together with the phone number. Actually, the person will be able to download himself the vaccination certificate. Next slide, please. So this is the flow. You can see there is an entrance, there is a recording, there is waiting room, there is vaccination and also observation room. And then the person can get the SMS and they also can be able to download himself the certificate. Next slide. All right, so this is the portal being used also by client. It is the previous one, actually it is being used by healthcare providers. And this one is being used by our client. Once we are vaccinated, using the link provided through SMS, you can go to that link. What we will be asked, actually it would be the code you received from that SMS after vaccination and also your phone number. And from there, you can check your vaccination status. Once you download, actually, we have the certificate like this one. This is mine. You can say, I've got now 3 doses. So you see all details are there. And then to make sure that the certificate which we are giving, actually, it is authentic. So we can also use a QR code to scan. And once you scan for vaccination, actually, you have this information. We'll have the code, which is at the beginning, not really on the certificate, because actually it is a unique one. So you can get your code and also the number of doses you have received, even the dates. So all details will be there. And then you can see down there, there is also COVID-19 vaccination verified, because actually this certificate, no one can use wrong, or they cannot exchange. So meaning that everyone using the code and the phone number, actually we can make sure that the vaccination card or the certificate is for that person who vaccinated. Next slide, please. So actually it was very few slides, but I think related to challenge and also listen and learn from these DHS too. So most of the challenges we have had and also listen and learn. So it is like what Dr. Edson presented, because actually all systems are the same. And it is the same system we're using also for testing and also the same for immunization, e-tracker for routine vaccination. Thank you a lot.
Okay, thank you very much, dear presenters. Good morning, good afternoon to everyone. My name is Dorfka Mugunga, senior DHIS implementer advisor, currently working as a coordinator for HISP Rwanda. HISP Rwanda, next please. HISP Rwanda is one of the HISP nodes, a global network of DHIS implementers. So our main intervention area, among the others, are supporting DHS implementers to implement DHS for routine HMIS data, collect aggregate and case-based data for vaccination, for logistics and commodities, disease surveillance, putting in place NCDs-related registries, oncology registry, and among the others. So as HISP Rwanda, we, as of now, we operate in the Central Africa region and Eastern Southern Africa regions, of course, serving both English and French speaking countries, Rwanda there, and of course, including Djibouti, that we may start supporting this year. Next, please. So with regards to implementing DHIS2 for real-time monitoring, for the sake of this presentation, we are looking at taking Rwanda as a use case among the countries that we are supporting. If I try to summarize a little bit on the health system in Rwanda, even though the previous presenter has mentioned it, in terms of health facilities, in terms of public institutions, public and private health facilities, there are quite a number of 1,000 health facilities being involved in COVID and COVID case management and vaccination. So as of now, country has been implementing DHIS countrywide in all health facilities, including public and private health facility, and also with regards to vaccination. So there are fixed sites, and there are also mobile sites. So fixed sites are based in the health facilities, but also mobile sites that are set based on target population. Next, please. Yeah, so Rwanda has been implementing DHIS for quite a number of years, starting 2012. So for all this long experience implementing DHIS, actually informed the decision making when the COVID started. So I've seen in the chat people asking how it happened for the ministry to opt for DHIS, to decide quickly and choose the partners in this process. So one of the key factors was to the previous experience and working relationship with the HISP Rwanda and the government of Rwanda supporting different DHIS implementation, as you can see on this graph. So since 2012, there are quite a number of DHIS implementation that has been going on. Some are aggregate reporting systems integrated into the national HMI system. Others are case-based reporting, namely TB tracker, death audits, performance-based financing, having AP tracker to track throughout the routine immunization children, so the routine immunization schedule, and also nutrition tracker among the others. So all, with all this experience actually contributed much to smooth support when it comes to real-time monitoring of COVID cases during the surveillance and when this vaccination started. So DHIS to was considered as if I can say, a central platform to build systems to support the COVID outbreak. Next, please. So here I'm being more focusing only on technical part of DHIS. So in Rwanda, as the previous presenters expressed, DHIS has been used to support COVID case surveillance and also COVID vaccination activities in the country. Starting with the COVID case registry and data sharing, I'll be quick on this. So the system itself helps to capture profile information, means the unique identifier, the ID of the person, names and everything, but also helps to correct lab requests. So whether PCR tests or rapid tests, so all are integrated into the DHIS registry. And also from there, a lab can also enter lab results. So as you've seen from previous presenters, every time when a person reaches to the facility and gets registered in the system, he automatically gets SMS, and that SMS comes with the unique identifier by that time. But as of now, it has been upgraded after doing the interoperability with the National Population Registry, whereby all demographic names, ID, birth details are all fetched from that system to feed directly through the interoperability works that has been done. Of course, the traveler, the COVID registry has been implemented and it gradually get improved to accommodate, of course, changes that have been happening in the COVID case management, starting from the passenger locator form, traveler locator form, whereby passengers are filling arrival details, and once they arrive at the airport, they can automatically find their records synchronized with the national DHIS registry, And from there, the officials at the airport can automatically simply register lab request information and later on results. Of course, throughout the implementation, number of interoperability works has been done, as some of the previous presenters mentioned, namely the online result portal where people can publicly access their results, status and certificate, but also the life keep on improving. So people are selling out tickets for different events. So they need to issue a ticket for a person that they are quite sure that that person is really tested negative. And of course, those who are in the quarantine, because sometimes people come based on changes in the management of cases, they may introduce quarantine hotels. So people in the hotel, they need to have a dashboard to pulling information from the national system to know this person results are out, so we can release the person to go home. So all those interoperability works has been done, of course, including as Rwanda as a landlocked, and also people are traveling, they need a travel pass. So number of interoperability works has been done to integrate with the EAC, East African Community System, and also a common pass for HESP pass, and also AU pass to people traveling in Africa. Next, please. So with regards to COVID vaccination also registry, it also actually, it's a separate, if I can say registry, because looking at the flow information, request to the server, so we realized that one registry can handle both, can manage registry, can manage customer surveillance and also respond to vaccination, looking at the number of users on daily basis and also if I can say, the traffic of requests to the server. So this vaccination registry also interact, give us a chance to whoever is vaccinated to access a certificate portal, as the previous presenter Hassan presented, by providing whether the phone number and the unique ID provided by the system, or using the ID, the national identification number, and also the phone number to be able to access certificates, because that was kind of a restriction to ensure that people's information are publicly exposed. And as I said, the interoperability with the National Population Registry database helps to ensure that the identification of people, especially going back to what Hassan presented, ensuring that the target population, the people that you are targeting, are really registered population of the country, and also we assure that you are faxing the right people. So this interoperability also improves the quality of data, and also being able to identify individuals. So the vaccination registry also offers the USCD interface, because everybody can't access internet everywhere. People have small phones, they can easily prove that they are vaccinated, especially when they are attending public spaces, when they are using buses, and also for number of, let's say, at the health facility, where they want to show that everybody is vaccinated, or being able to prove that they are vaccinated to whoever is requesting those information. Next, please. Yeah, so as of now, implementing those registries, whether vaccination and COVID surveillance, this slide just to give you a quick overview of the how traffic it is for these instances. Taking an example of COVID vaccination, as of now, we have more than 9 million tracked entity registered in the COVID. So it means that more than 15 million vaccination events has been created, and more than 500 vaccination sites. These are fixed sites, and also mobile sites These mobile sites might be set anywhere depending on the plan of the immunization program. Looking at the case severance, as of now, the system has recorded so far more than 2,500 testing sites. It means including mobile and fixed. Here I can mention that the big part of testing sites are for rapid testing. And as of now, if I'm not mistaken, around 4 or 5 testing sites for PCR are created in the system. So, which means more than 9.5 million of rapid test events has been recorded in the system, and more than 3 million tracked entities has been tested. So it means this, you see how the traffic is with the COVID case surveillance system and also vaccination. So to roll out and also maintain all these systems, of course, there have to be some strategies. There have to be well-identified sites. So this requires that almost all health facilities, including whether public, means health center, district hospital, provincial and referral hospitals, including private clinics and hospitals, are contributing to this huge traffic that you can see. There are special sites for vaccination. They can be in schools, markets, bus station, military police barracks to ensure that every person who wants to get vaccinated or wants to get tested can get the service. So all this shows how big the number of users are going to be, how big is going to be the traffic to the servers. And if let's say you are combining tablets and laptops, so you are going to see also, you feel, you can realize how the workload increases to the server sides and also to the application side. So this is achievable because on every, whether a testing site or a vaccination site, there, as you have seen in the previous presenters' pictures, we have a person in charge of data. So there can be many depending on people seeking for service for that very specific site. And we should have also vaccinators or testing, clinicians testing, and also we should have supervisors for the site. So that has contributed to the success of what you are seeing or what we are sharing with you, because if we couldn't have that organization, it would be very difficult for the country to manage this free information, this high traffic request to the server. So may having multiple server downtime and also difficulties. Of course we did, but looking on how the organization was set, actually it has really much help to keep up with the demand. Next, please. Yeah, here with this slide, I wanted to share with the people here present some key success factors, especially implementing DHIS2 for real-time for real-time data management. One of if I can say, COVID case management and COVID vaccination. So in collaboration with the WHO, UNICEF, and University of Oslo, modules have been developed, reviewed, of course, and well documented to support whoever wants to implement DHIS for COVID case management or COVID vaccination, have that module ready to be deployed. So that has contributed much to time, because with regards to dealing with outbreaks, sometimes we don't have much time. So you are dealing with a very short deadlines request, and you need to have something to present. So having those modules ready reviewed by experts, documented for deployments, was one of the key suspects that we want to share with you, so that whoever wants their modules ready to be deployed, of course, with minor contextualization process, but with almost 8% of what is needed. So there have to be ownership and also a trust in DHIS. So one of the key factors in Rwanda is that DHIS, based on the previous experience working with the tool, they really have that trust that DHIS can do something. So trusting, owning the tool, of course, I can't say DHIS is 100% perfect, but it might have some bugs, they have some issues. I'll share that in the challenges. But having that trust and previous experience using DHIS has also increased the ownership and trust in the technology. Of course, a strong coordination mechanism in place, whereby a multiple sectorial team contributed to deployment of the tool and also supporting the tool implementation among coordination team. We have, of course, health experts, the involvement of police and defense, technologists, the Minister of ICT, Rwanda Information, Security Agency, and partners, including partner WHO country office, UNICEF, mobile operators. So you need to have a multi-sectorial team to make sure that you have a full support to make sure that your rollout goes successful. Because sometimes the deployment of this technological solution becomes, let's say, for the AP program responsibility. So, but having that synergy among partners has contributed much to the success of this DHIS solution. Also, having a technical support team, building on the existing working relationship with the Ministry of Health and collaboration with UIO and other technology supporting team, ready to change the request problems into solutions. That was also in a very short time, that was also contributed much to deployment of this DHIS technology. Of course, as I said, Ministry of Health facilities, RBC, we quite have good experience using tracker in the system, as you've seen the previous slide, and also the internet coverage. So the internet, because when you are using a web, you are implementing any web application, even though we've been relying to use the Android app, but sometimes looking at the high traffic, you need to use computers, and computers can't work offline. So you may need computers to do fast some of the recordings, especially for the busy testing site or vaccination site. Next, please. Yeah, here I just want to share also some best practices. So looking how the high traffic to the server applications, we started having server issues we decided to separate, if I can say, to have dedicated servers for different thing. Let's say you have a dedicated server for application and proxy, you have a dedicated server for database, and you have a dedicated server for data analysis and report. So this is because in Rwanda, it's possible to have, let's say, 200,000 people recorded per day across from all health vaccination sites. So with that very huge access records in the system, you can't have, and also have also my other people busy doing analysis works. So sometimes server may not keep up with those requests. So we decided to have, if I can say, a Miller server to have a backup of what we have in what we can say a production server dedicated only to support for analysis. So that was also a strategy that can be replicated elsewhere. The also thing we did is to combine use of tablets and PCs, because sometimes, let's say having 4,000 tablets synchronizing to the server might also create problems. So we try to have a combined materials deployment using tablets and PCs, especially to mitigate with the very high registration, high traffic of information. Also, you, as a good practice, you need also to monitor its proxy, especially when you are doing mass vaccination campaign, especially, for example, at this time, people are quite, like say, we are in Rwanda, they are busy vaccinating, almost as you've seen the previous presenters' PowerPoints. A very big part of the population is being covered by vaccination service. So during that mass campaign, you need to make sure that you have a regular monitoring of your proxy to see how your proxy server is managing, is behaving. Of course, as I said, a technology solution may not be 100% perfect. So we collaboration with the University of Oslo developers team has also helped us to have in time, if I can say, review of the WAR files to make sure that it's more appropriate to what is happening. Next, please. This, for example, I'll give an example where we managed to so DHIS, looking at the DHIS tracker module, you need to do a search of a person. So initially, the search function, we're looking for like item, but when you look for like item, see it can display so many, a very long list of individuals, but changing from like to exact match has actually contributed and optimized the search and also improved the server processes time. Of course, using the SMS, because when someone is tested, even though before getting the results or even get vaccinated, receiving an SMS is also, we have realized that it's a very good practice to, even people are really confident that I have received these services, this is a proof, this is the SMS. Because you may find that service, that SMS is, it can be presented somewhere, say, okay, I've been tested in this lab, in this facility, or I've been vaccinated in this facility. So you find it simplifies people's life also, be like a supporting information to present where it's requested.
Adolf, yes. I'm sorry, Adolf, it's so interesting, but we're a bit over time, and I wanted to give a chance to the WHO as well to speak. We are going to share the presentation and also the recording, and also we will provide an answer to all the questions. I think still 14 questions not yet answered, so we'll provide all by writing. But maybe, Adolf, you can just wrap up in one few seconds and we give it to Vedaste.
Yeah, thank you very much. Let me go quickly to challenges that we have faced. Some of the challenges we face, just realized that the DHIS hasn't been really tested for large implementation with high traffic. So that's something you need to be aware of and maybe progressively monitor that. And also sometimes having custom forms may not work for tablets. And also issues when it comes to interoperability, data security policies and agreements for data shared for shared records across, let's say, regional bodies, AU and ESC, because they're not quite sure that there's not a legal framework or, if I can say, mechanism to ensure data security shared across. So that's what I can add, and the rest people can go through the PowerPoint, and maybe we can have more time for questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Adolf. Thank you, everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. My name is Dr. Vedas Indahindwa. I'm the public health officer at WHO Rwanda Country Office, and I work primarily in a data emergency team, and I support also data management and data science cell at the task force. So a lot have been said, have been shared on this. I will be somehow brief because my predecessors have said a lot and very long. But we know that Rwanda has a lot really to share about the experience of real-time monitoring and digital solutions. So this was built long before the start of COVID-19. And we know that Rwanda has a very strong immunization system and other system, and the different platforms that it was said were already available at the beginning of the pandemic. So Rwanda COVID-19 response and the vaccination rollout success is mainly a result of high political commitment and sound vaccination delivery structure, including these digital solutions we are talking here about. There are different successes, different that have been raised, have been said. I'm not repeating that, but we are really proud of the achievement that Rwanda have achieved, both in managing COVID-19 outbreak in the country and also the vaccine delivery that is high. We know that Rwanda has achieved the 40% target of WHO by the end of last year. And now we are at around 58% of fully vaccinated to all over the population. And really we believe that by the end of July, will be, or by the beginning of July, we'll be achieving the 70% as recommended. So this is, we are really saying that because of what we've observed, the available systems that are available, and the benefit we have gained using these platforms and these digital solutions. So briefly, what we have observed is that the system that were created were not really dormant system. They have been used for planning, monitoring, and evidence-based decision-making. So this was partly the success of these systems because it could not have been so high success if the system were not used. We know that on daily basis, we had reporting. On weekly basis, we had additional reporting, different meetings, and all decisions were really driven by what is the collected as data on daily basis. So for now, we are proud that equity in distribution of vaccine was high, and also other achievement that were really achieved on this was basically and linked, mainly linked to the use of the system. So the recommendation from WHO is really to scale up at all levels and extend to different other conditions and disease, so that this solution, because it have now been adopted at different levels, like laboratory is no longer using paper-based and other also solutions. We believe that data use will also strengthen, enhance the improvement of the systems and use for better improvement of life and healthcare delivery in Rwanda. So without being long, because the main part was discussed with my colleagues, I want really to give back the floor and maybe proceed to the next item on the agenda. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Maybe I'll kind of wrap up. We are way over time, but still more than 100 people are connected. So let's take time to conclude nicely. I wanted again to really share the big thank you on behalf of Gavi. I've even called Imran as a panelist so we can see him, and Imran, Raquel, and Voshik from UNICEF headquarters have been really, key to move forward on this agenda. WHO has been always collaborating. For this particular example, we know the commitment of the HIS2 community of practice and the role of HISP here, the role of HISP Rwanda. And of course, most important, the main partner, our government. So again, thank you to the representative of the government of Rwanda. I think you have a chance to see all the enthusiasm in the chat, in the question and answer. Of course, there is challenges, but having committed people and government and partners showing the path and sharing the lesson learned is really critical and can help all the countries to improve the real-time data use for COVID-19, beyond COVID-19 for immunization program in routine in campaign and beyond that for other health programs as well. So again, big thank you. We are going to share slides, recording, question and answer. The documents are already posted on the Gavi website and will be also shared widely in the community of practices. So, closing now, unless anyone, from UNICEF or Rwanda or WHO, someone want to say bye, go ahead.
Thank you all very much for joining. Thank you so much to our colleagues from the Government of Rwanda and from WHO, from HISP, for participating. And we look forward to meeting some of our Francophone colleagues again soon when we organize the French version of this webinar. Thank you and have a very good day or evening wherever you are. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye. Thanks.